complex number is denoted by Z, or we can say G. Complex number first came with the quadratic equation. Let take one example that we have x square plus x plus 1 is equal to 0, and we want the roots of this equation. Then if we see the discriminant of this equation is equal to b square minus 4ac, that is 1 square minus 4, it will come minus 3, which is less than 0. Therefore, the roots of this equation are not real. So for solving this equation, we came with a new definition, that definition is defined by a complex number. The root of this equation, if we solve this equation, then we get x equal to minus b means minus 1 plus minus root over b square minus 4ac upon 2a, means it will come minus 1 plus minus under root minus 3 upon 2. So this minus 3, root over minus 3, which is not a real number, this is not a real number, not real. And we need some definition, some concept for solving root in negative. For that, we introduce one term, that is I. And this I is equal to root over minus 1. So by putting this value in this equation, we can write this equation as minus 1 plus minus under root minus 1 into under root 3 divided by 2. So this under root minus 1 will be come to represent like I. So our root will be minus 1 plus minus root 3i upon 2. This is our complex number. I should explain this I letter in this chapter. Before that, we write complex number z equal to x plus I y, where x and y are real number. So this x represents real z. Real z means complex number, and this y is our imaginary z, means x shows, that is x is our is real part of z, and y is imaginary part of z. Like in this example, we can say that real z, in short we write this real z is equal to minus 1, while imaginary z is equal to root over 3. This is the basic concept to show a complex number. Thus, z can be written as x plus iy, or we can say real z plus I time imaginary z. This is our complex number. Now, one thing you may note down, that if y is equal to 0, then z is equal to x. In this case, means y equal to 0 means imaginary part of imaginary z is 0. That our number is a real number. In another, if x equal to 0, then our z will equal to I y, means real z equal to 0. So this is our real number, while this is our purely imaginary, and this is purely real. So you can see that if I say that a number, we can say that z equal to 3, then this may be written as 3 plus 0 I. So any real number can be represented as imaginary number, means complex number. But complex number, purely complex number, cannot be represented as purely real number. So all real numbers are, we can say that all real numbers are subset of all complex numbers. So real numbers are subset of complex number. Thus in case of 0, 0 is both real number and complex number, because 0 can be written as 0 plus 0 I. So this is real and complex both. As an example, if I write z equal to 2 plus 3i, in this case real z is equal to 2 while imaginary z is equal to 3. So one thing you also know that imaginary z means imaginary part of z is 3. This is not 3i. This is not 3i. This is incorrect. This is incorrect. If someone asks what is the imaginary part of z, then it is 3 only, not 3i. I represent imaginary part. I represent imaginary part. And what is imaginary part? That y is the imaginary part. So if I can say z equal to some 4 minus 5i, then again real z is our 4 and imaginary z is minus 5. Because always we write this as 4 plus minus 5i. Again, as in one more example, if we can write 3i, then real z is our 0 while imaginary z is 3. So this number is purely imaginary number. Purely imaginary number. If I can write z equal to 2, then you don't say that this 2 is a real number. This 2, because we can write this as 2 plus 0i. So again, this real z is 2 while imaginary z is 0. That imaginary part of z is 0 means this number is purely real. So real number can be algebra of complex number. In this first, you see what is equal means when two complex numbers are equal. If I can say z1 is equal to x1 plus iy1 and z2 is equal to x2 plus iy2, then z1 is equal to z2 if only if both real z1 is must be equal to real z2 and imaginary z1 must be equal to imaginary z2. Means real part and imaginary part, both part must be equal to 0. Or we can say that x1 must be equal to x2 and y1 must be equal to y2. As example, if I can say z1 is equal to 2 plus 3i and z2 equal to a plus bi. If z1 is equal to z2, then a must be equal to 2 and b must be equal to 3. And only in this case they both are equal. Another property of this is if I can say z1 is equal to 2 plus 3i and z2 equal to 1 plus 2i. Then I can ask which is greater, whether z2 is greater than z1 or z1 is greater than z2. So one thing you must note down that in complex number there is no inequality. So there is no inequality in complex number. Complex number cannot be compared with each other. If I can say real z1 is equal to 2 greater than real z2 and imaginary z1 is equal to 3 which is greater than imaginary z2, these both statements are correct. But if I can say z1 is greater than z2, then this statement is incorrect because there is no comparison of complex numbers. Means in complex number we can't say that which is greater than and which is smaller. Now addition or subtraction. Addition and subtraction of two complex number. Let z1 is equal to x1 plus iy1 and z2 equal to x2 plus iy2. Then z1 plus z2 must be equal to x1 plus x2 plus I times y1 plus y2, and z1 minus z2 is equal to x1 minus x2 plus I times y1 minus y2. So in complex number, we add or subtract, we add or subtract real part with real part and complex part with complex part. Means real part doesn't add with add or subtract with complex part, and complex part neither add or subtract with real part. Similarly, multiplication Z1 into Z2. This is our multiplication. This is solved just like this, plus I Y1 X2 plus I Y2. Then multiply each term, we get X1 into X2 plus I time X1 Y2 plus I time Y1 X2 plus I square Y1 Y2. And this I square we defined as is iota, as I square is equal to minus 1. Therefore, Z1 into Z2 will be equal to X1 X2 plus minus Y1 Y2 plus I time X1 Y2 plus Y1 X2. So this is, if I represent as capital Z, then this is real Z part and this is imaginary Z part. So again, in multiplication, real part in which I is not there should be separate and imaginary part should be separate. Now come to the division. In division, we do not divide division like in algebra, that if I divide x square by x, then this is equal to x, or we can say 2x cube upon x square is equal to 2x. This division not apply in complex numbers. So what is the process of division? Let Z1 upon Z2 we have to find out, means X1 plus I Y1 upon X2 plus I Y2. So in this case, what we have to do, this denominator part, we have to change this denominator part as a real part, because we can divide any number with real part, but we can't divide any number with imaginary part. That means we can divide 2 divided by 3. We can divide 2 plus 3i divided by 3. But we can't divide 2 divided by 2 plus 3i. This is not valid in imaginary part. So again, this we multiply numerator and denominator by x2 minus I y2 upon x2 minus I y2. So this will come as, denominator will come like x2 square plus y2 square, because I square is equal to minus 1, and upper part is a multiplication of two complex number with negative sign. So it will come as x1 x2 plus y1 y2 plus I time y1 x2 minus x1 y2. So this is the process of division. We can't directly divide the complex numbers. Complex numbers satisfy most of the properties of real number, like commutative law or associative law. Means Z1 plus Z2 is equal to Z2 plus Z1. Similarly, we can say Z1 plus Z2 plus Z3 is equal to Z1 plus Z2 plus Z3. This also gives additive identity, that is Z plus 0 is a complex number is equal to 0 plus Z, where 0 is written as 0 plus 0i. This is a complex number, while these are real number. Similarly, this also satisfies additive inverse, that is Z plus some complex number W must be equal to 0, or we can say w is equal to minus z. So if z is equal to x plus iy, then additive inverse w is equal to minus x minus iy. Similarly, all these property also satisfy in multiplication also, that is commutative and associative. Z1 into Z2 must be equal to Z2 into Z1, or we can say Z1 Z2 into Z3 is equal to Z1 into Z2 into Z3. And we have identity also, that which is known as multiplication identity, means Z into some complex number W is equal to Z. Then this W must be equal to 1 plus 0 i. As an example, if Z is equal to X plus I Y, then and W is our 1 plus 0 i, then Z into W is equal to X plus I Y into 1 plus 0 i, then this again will give X plus I Y. So this W is multiplication identity. Similarly we have inverse identity. We can say multiplication inverse identity. In this, if this is written as that, such that Z into W must be equal to 1. So if Z is equal to X plus IY, then we can say W is equal to 1 upon X plus IY. Again, this is a division, we multiply and divide with X minus IY and X minus IY. So we get X minus IY upon X square plus Y square. This means this X square, X minus IY and X square plus IY are multiplication inverse of X plus IY. And again, all these properties are followed with associative law, distributive law and other properties. Now I will explain you some more property of iota, means I. See, we know that I is equal to under root minus 1. So any number which is negative of square root can be written as I. Just as example, under root minus 3, it can be written as under root minus 1 into 3, means this is under root minus 1 into under root 3, means this can be written as root 3 into I. Another property of this is that if I is equal to root over 1, we can write as I square is equal to minus 1. Again, multiplying this with I, we can say I cube is equal to minus I. Again, multiplying this with I, we write as I 4 equal to minus I square, which is minus 1 into minus 1, which is again 1. So I equal to root minus 1, I square equal to minus 1, I cube equal to minus I, and I 4 equal to 1. This process repeat after 4 multiplication of 4, means I 5 again we will get root minus 1, I 6 we get minus 1, I 7 minus I, I 8 again 1. So in general we can write this as I ka power 4n plus 1 equal to root minus 1, I ka power 4n plus 2 equal to minus 1, I ka power 4n plus 3 is equal to minus I, and I ka power 4n plus 4, this is equal to 1. Or this may be also written as I ka power 4n. So this will give the value of I at different n. Similarly, we can write as 1 upon I, means inverse of I, is equal to 1 upon I multiply numerator and denominator with I, we get I divided by I square, means I divided by minus 1, means this is equal to minus I. Similarly, if want to calculate 1 upon I square, then this is equal to minus I into 1 upon I. So again I will cancel, this will give minus 1. If you want to calculate 1 upon I ka power cube, then again minus 1 into 1 upon I. Multiply numerator and denominator with I. So I square equal to minus 1 will cancel and it will give I. So this process repeats, again repeat in negative power of I also. Now after knowing the value of I, which is under minus 1, we can easily solve cube root of unity. Let x is equal to 1 ka power 1 by 3. Then we get x cube equal to 1, and again x cube minus 1 is equal to 0. Solving this equation, we get x minus 1, x square plus x plus 1 is equal to 0. So again solving these two equations, we get the value of x is equal to 1, minus 1 plus root 3 I by 2, and minus 1 minus root 3 I by 2. So these three are cube root of unity, and these three are represented as 1, omega and omega square. One more thing you note down, that we can also write this as 1 omega square or omega. So whether I say omega equal to minus 1 plus root 3 I by 2 or minus 1 minus root 3 I by 2, it doesn't matter. So if we square this omega square, let's square positive term, then it is minus 1 plus root 3 I by 2 whole square. After squaring, you will get same value, that minus 1 minus root 3 I by 2. In the reverse process, if you assume omega equal to minus 1 minus root 3 I by 2, then squaring this, you will get plus value. So our cube root of unity are 1, omega and omega square. The properties of this cube root are the sum of root 1 plus omega square, this must be equal to 0. And product of the cube root of unity, 1 into omega square, this is equal to 1. So we can write as omega cube equal to 1. So we have two properties, that summation is equal to 0 and omega cube equal to 1. So in general, we can write this omega ka power n. N is any number. This can be written as multiple of omega ka power 3n. Then omega ka power 3n means omega cube equal to 1. Then omega 3n power 3n are equal to 1. Then omega 3n plus 1, this is equal to omega. And omega 3n plus 2, this is equal to omega square. This is very basic property of cube root of unity. Modulus of a complex number is denoted by Z mod, and the conjugate of a complex number is denoted by Z bar. Let Z be any complex number represented by x plus iy, then Z modulus equal to root over x square plus y square, or we can say Z mod root square equals x square plus y square. Similarly, conjugate of Z bar is represented by x minus iy, means real part will take same sign while imaginary part changes sign from positive to negative or negative to positive, vice versa. From these two definitions, we can get one property of conjugate and modular, that if we multiply Z into Z bar, means x plus iy into x minus iy, which on multiply give x square plus y square, and we know that x square plus y square equal to Z mod whole square. Therefore Z bar equal to Z mod whole square. From this we can get Z inverse equal to 1 by Z, that is Z conjugate divided by Z mod ka whole square. Some other property of modulus and conjugate are like this, that Z1 into Z2 whole mod is equal to Z1 mod Z2 mod. Similarly, in case of bar, Z1 bar into Z2 bar ka mod is equal to Z1 bar mod Z2 bar mod. And Z bar is another complex number. And similarly, Z1 into Z2 multiplication whole conjugate is equal to Z1 conjugate into Z2 conjugate. We can take separate conjugates. Same property in plus minus, z1 plus minus z2 whole conjugate is equal to z1 conjugate plus minus z2 conjugate. Another property is in division, that z1 upon z2 whole mod is equal to z1 mod upon z2 mod. Similarly, z1 upon z2 mod conjugate is equal to z1 conjugate upon z2 conjugate whole mod. These are the property of modulus and conjugate of a complex number. This is very important topic in complex number, that is Argand plane. As in real number, we have two coordinates, x and y. Similarly, in complex plane, or we can say Argand plane, this x represents real z and y represents imaginary z. So let there is a complex number z which is represented by x plus I y, and this x plus I y is represented in a complex plane, or we can say Argand plane. Then draw a line from origin to z and take one perpendicular and assume this angle theta, and we know that z modulus is equal to x square plus y square. This is our root over, this is our r, and this r is this mean distance of this point z from origin. Similarly, this distance is our x, or in polar we can write this r cos theta, and this distance is our y, and polar it is represented as r sin theta. So again, from this equation, if we write r square means this z square, r square may equal to r cos theta whole square plus r sin theta whole square, which is equal to r square cos square theta plus sin square theta, which is equal to r square. So this is hypotenuse in which base give real number and height give imaginary number. This is the Argand plane, or we can say complex plane. Now what is this theta? This theta is written as ARGZ, means argument of Z. Theta is argument of complex number Z. In short, it is written as ARGZ. So if we can write want to find the value of tan theta, then we can write as tan theta is equal to this y by x. And what is y? What is this? Is imaginary z upon x real z. So in short, so we can say that theta is equal to tan inverse imaginary z divided by real z, and this theta is ARGZ, means argument of z. Now in polar form, represent z in terms of r and theta. Again, let's draw one coordinate axis. This is x and y, real z or imaginary z, and this is our z, which is x plus I y. Distance r and theta. One thing more, note down, theta we always take in anti clockwise direction, in anti clockwise direction from positive x axis. We always take in anti clockwise direction from positive x axis. Now if we write, we know that x is equal to r cos theta and y is equal to r sin theta. Therefore, z we can write as r cos theta plus r sin theta into I. Then we can write as z equal to r cos theta plus I sin theta. So this is the polar represent of a complex number in modulus and argument, and r represent mod and theta represent argument of a complex number. And one thing more, note down that this theta, if this theta is rotate with 2 pi, then again we will get theta. Again in rotation 2 pi, again we will get theta. Means for this value, we have several values. Theta with the period, time period of 2 pi. 2 pi plus theta, 2, 4 pi plus minus theta, 6 pi. So for deleting this confusion, we use one term, that is our principal argument. Normally it is denoted by ARGZ, means A is a capital, and for that we use small a. And principal argument, what we represent, that theta must lie between pi to minus pi. This is very important. Then theta is minus pi to pi, means either we go from here to whole round in anticlockwise direction, pi, means from positive x-axis to negative x-axis, and in anticlockwise direction, in anticlockwise direction, we go just behind the x-axis, that is minus pi, and this is equal to pi and this is less than pi. So theta vary from minus pi to pi. If we have angle z in second quadrant, then we will represent as pi by 2 plus some angle theta. If it is in third quadrant, then we will write in negative of theta. If it is in fourth quadrant, then again we will write in negative of theta. That I will explain you with some examples. Now take one example. Let z equal to 1 plus I root 3. Then our real part 1 equal to r cos theta and root 3 equal to r sin theta. Squaring and adding both, we get r square equal to 1 plus 3, means r equal to 2. Then this r equal to 2 is our z mod. Similarly, if we divide this sin theta and cos theta, then tan theta equal to r sin theta by r cos theta, which will get root 3. So theta equal to pi by 3. This is our argz, argument of z. From this, if we go reverse, then x equal to r cos theta, then r 2 cos pi by 3, then we get 1, and y equal to r sin theta, 2 sin pi by 3, 2 into root 3 by, which is root 3, which is again we get z equal to x plus I y, means 1 plus I root 3. Now with 4 example, we take 1, z1 equal to 1 plus I root 3, z2 equal to 1 minus I root 3, z3 minus 1 minus I root 3, z4 minus 1 plus I root 3. And for this z1, we already calculated that theta is our pi by 3. So this, if we represent this in argand plane, then this theta is our this. This is our pi by 3, which is ARG z1 in anti-clockwise direction. For z2, we have 1 minus I root 3, means real part is positive, imaginary part is negative. Then it will come in fourth quadrant. And in fourth quadrant, our theta is minus pi by 3. This is ARG z2. Now in z3, we have both negative, means real part and imaginary part both are negative. Means it will come in the third part. It will come in the third quadrant. So in third quarter it will be negative, and what negative means this angle is pi by 3, this angle is pi by 3. So we get this angle, this whole angle, and this angle is negative of pi minus pi by 3. This is our ARG z3. Similarly for z4, minus 1 plus I root 3, means this x real part is negative, imaginary part is positive. So again our theta is this. This is our theta, angle pi by 3. But from we are measuring from positive x-axis, so we will get this angle as pi minus pi by 3, which is equal to 2 pi by 3. This is your argument z4. So one thing you note down, whether it is in first quadrant, second, third or fourth. Always we take argument from 0 to pi in positive and from 0 to minus pi in negative. In positive it is equal to 0 to pi, mean this pi equal, but in negative it is less than pi. So theta is vary between positive pi less than equal to negative pi. This is our principal argument.